हम अहमद बच्चे हैं कुछ करके दिखा देंगे.
Welcome to a new episode of Children's Corner. For the next half an hour, we will watch three segments: Tajweed-ul-Quran, Let's Ask, and of course, Sketch. So let's start with Tajweed-ul-Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Dear children, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to the program Children's Corner with the segment called Tahseen-ul-Quran, which means beautification of the Holy Quran. In this segment, we are going to play in each program 2 to 3 tilawat recorded on voicemail, and then after playing that tilawat, I will highlight the common errors and give my feedback to the reciter. Remember that there are 4 important components of a good tilawat, and if any component is missing or is weak, then that tilawat cannot be called a good tilawat. The first one is makharijul huruf, that we should make sure that our letters are properly pronounced, articulated. There are 29 letters in Arabic, and each letter has its own property and quality. There are similar sounding letters, and we should make a difference between those similar sounding letters. The second component is al-mudud, which means that prolongation or elongation. There are certain letters which we have to pronounce in elongation. We have to prolong that, we have to shorten certain letters, and this is common in all over the Holy Quran, in the text of the Holy Quran. And the third component is idgham, which means assimilation or joining of two letters or two words. And the fourth one is waqf, which means stop and make a pause in between a verse or at the end of a verse. With this brief introduction, let us listen to the first recorded tilawat, and this tilawat is of Mubariz Durrani.
Alif Lam Mim Dhalikal Kitabu La Rayba Fih هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون.
Okay, Jazakumullah. Now, overall tilawat was good. First of all, I like to mention that there are 2 levels of recitation in terms of learning and teaching. The first one is the basic level and the rules which we practice in Yassal Quran. And the second level, which is advanced level, because of the age group, I will highlight the common errors regarding keeping in mind the first level. Now, Mubariz has pronounced Yu'minuna. Yu'minuna has come twice in these recited verses. And here on waw, yu'minuna, the first waw has a hamza, and here jerking sound is needed, and ayn sound should not be pronounced because ayn is not there, but it has been pronounced with ayn. It should be pronounced with jerk but without addition of ayn, like yu'minuna, not yu'minuna. The second word, which is as-salah, which has not been properly paused, and make sure that when you make a pause, then it should be elonged, like it should not be suffocated. Like, for example, وَيُقِيمُ نَصَّلَاهُ. So, lam, which is with vertical fatha, it should be prolonged. And then ha should be added at the end. And again, another mistake of waqf, which is unzila. Then our second unzila has not been properly paused there, because if you pause a consonant, then that fatha or kasra or dhamma should not be pronounced, and the letter will be mute. Apart from this one, the tilawat was good, and if he continues to do practice and avoid these errors, he will be a good reciter. Now we move to second tilawat, which is of Rana Abdul Muqeed.
Alif Lam Mim. Zalikal Kitabu La Rayba Fi Hudan Lil Muttaqin Allazina Yu'minuna Bil Ghaybi Wa Yuqimuna As-Salata وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ.
MashaAllah, Rana Abdul Muqeed has a good voice and he has done a beautiful tilawat, but I like to highlight a couple of mistakes. First of all, with La. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. Remember that this la, lam followed by alif, and it is pronounced like la. And alif is a harfe madda, is a letter of prolongation. And it has not been pronounced in this example. La means not. And if we do not keep elongation properly on certain letters, on certain words, then the meaning could change. I give you one example that La ilaha illallah, that there is absolutely no God, none worthy of worship except Allah. And here, Dhalikal Kitabu La Rayba Fih, reference is being made to the Holy Quran, that this is the book, there is absolutely no doubt in it. And if La, Lam with Fatha, not followed by Alif, if it is pronounced, it means sure. Like, for example, Inna Rabbakum La Raufur Rahim. La Raufun, surely very kind, very compassionate. So La always should be prolonged, otherwise the meaning would change. And where Lam with Fatha in the meaning of sure or certainly, it must not be prolonged, otherwise the meaning would change. Again, the fi here, the proper pause was not made, and the pause waqf was suffocated. It should be prolonged, because in waqf we always prolong. And again, there is a mistake of waqf or elongation in the word yuqimuna. Now remember that yuqimuna, qaf followed by ya, and he has prolonged that one, because this is harfe madda, letter of prolongation. And the same with meem followed by waw, which is also should be prolonged, but it has been suffocated, it has not been properly prolonged, so it should be given the same time. Remember that there are three letters of prolongation. Without them, a letter cannot be prolonged up to two normal blinks of eye or 2 seconds. Now it's a qaf followed by ya, qi, and meem followed by waw. Meem with the dhamma is mu. So it's a yuqi mu same time should be given to both letters of prolongation. Again, on the word as-salah, again here the ta has been pronounced, which should be not be pronounced in waqf, because in this is called ta-e marbuta, connecting ta, and when making a waqf, it should not be pronounced. It should be pronounced like that, as-salah. The two dots will be removed and ha will remain there. Apart from that one, the voice was beautiful, and alhamdulillah, inshallah ta'ala, with a good practice, he will be a good reciter. Now, with this, we conclude this segment with the hope that inshallah ta'ala, until the next program, we will come with more tilawats, more examples. Until next program, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
You can call the number on your screen and record your tilawat on voicemail. We will then select and play them in future programs. But for now, let's move on to Let's Ask.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Abdul Rahman and I'm your host. Today we have with us Mr. Ramzan Sharif, who will be assisting in answering a few questions on the topic of hats and topis. Assalamu alaikum, Mr. Ramzan Sharif.
Wa alaikum assalam, Abdul, and the pleasure is all mine.
Why do we wear a topi? Is it only during namaz that we need it?
I think I will start by saying that topi means a hat or a cap, which is widely used for a number of purposes. Just take a look at the Australian culture, our own culture, and you will find that it has become part of our Australian dress code. In fact, if you look around in your own homes, you will find a number of hats that is used by you or your family. Can you, Abdul, think of one use of hat in Australia?
Yes, the baseball cap, which we can use for outdoor activities.
Of course, the baseball players wear baseball caps, and similarly are the cricketers' caps. And then again, there are the cowboy hats and the farmer's hats and the outback hats. They all have broad brims to provide shade from the strong sunlight. And again, you must have seen a magician's top hat, which has become an icon for magic. The hat trick is a classic magic trick where the performer produces an object, traditionally a rabbit or a bouquet of flowers, out of apparently empty top hat.
Very interesting. I'm now starting to learn the many purposes of hats.
And sayings too. For example, in the Western world, when someone says, man with many hats, it means a man who takes up many tasks, or it is about multitasking. And when someone says, my hat's off to you, it means a sign of respect and admiration.
What about the winter hats?
Let's talk about Australia again, where wool beanies are very common. And in Russia, the Russian fur caps with the ear flaps and are designed to protect the ears, jaw and the lower chin from the cold. What about your school? Do you require a hat in school, Abdul?
In school, we are required to wear a hat with the school emblem on it. And when we enter our classrooms, we are required to take the hat off, and we can only wear it during break times or sport.
This means that cap is part of the school dress code, and it serves a very important purpose. In fact, all hats serve a purpose, and similarly, the namaz caps are available as a head covering. You must have noticed that the namaz caps are available in a number of sizes, shapes and colors.
Even in my home, there are a variety of different caps, but this is my favorite cap, and I wear it to mosque every week.
And that cap may be favorite to so many other boys or to your own brothers too. There are various other types of caps, such as the skull cap that you are wearing right now, and then the Jinnah caps, which is identified with Muhammad Ali Jinnah, the Qaid-e Azam of Pakistan, and again the famous Turkish hat, more commonly known as the Lal Topi, that has been the pride of our own Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan, رضي الله تعالى عنه, who used it extensively. It's my turn to ask you a question now. What head covering does Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Khamis, Ayyadullah Ta'ala bin Nasrul Aziz, wear during Friday sermons?
A turban, which is white in color.
Very good. Yes, that's a great observation. While delivering the Friday sermon, in many other instances, Huzur wears a bright white turban. In fact, I should say that pagdi unko sajti hai. That means his turban looks good on him.
That makes a lot of sense.
And by now, we have made it very clear that for namaz, various designs and types of hats are available and used. They could be based on personal choice, that could be your choice, or even on their cultural and climatic conditions as well.
So much for the types of hats. Can you give us some advice on how the hat is put on? I mean, is there any particular things I have to consider before whilst putting the hat on?
For this, I will try to keep it simple and give three pieces of advice only in order to make it simple for our understanding. First and foremost, it should fit your head and your skull properly so that when you go in ruku or sajda, that is when you are bowing or when you are in prostration, it does not fall off and your concentration is not lost.
It makes a lot of sense because I don't want my concentration to be lost due to my hat falling off over and over again. Sorry for interrupting, but could you advise us on the other two pieces of how the hat is put on?
Of course. Secondly, the portion of hair that may fall on the forehead should be tucked inside the hat. And thirdly, the design of the hat should allow the forehead touch the ground. With toes, knees, palms, fingers and nose, the forehead should be touching the ground as well. That is why prostration is referred as the most humble position during namaz.
So far, so good. Is it compulsory for us to wear a cap during namaz?
I should say, in exceptional cases, one may be allowed to perform namaz without a cap. However, using a cap for namaz is a preferred tradition of the Holy Prophet, which we all should be eager to adopt. It is part and partial of our namaz. Let me ask you a simple question. And I will refer to the baseball cap since you mentioned this before when giving an example of a cap used in Australia. If it's namaz time and the only cap available is a baseball cap, will you use it for namaz?
Well, firstly, I will check if it's clean, and if it is so, I will use it by putting it backwards so it doesn't affect my prostration.
Well answered, Abdul. And I can see the wisdom in your thoughts too. Yes, wearing a hat adds to the beauty of an individual. And that is not only how you appear, but it is the spiritual beauty that we want to display in front of Allah Ta'ala. And at the same time, show full respect to Allah Ta'ala.
So a cap during namaz is intended for the spiritual beauty and respect for Allah Ta'ala. I'm a little bit confused because as soon as I enter my classroom, my teacher asks me to remove my hat. So my question is wearing the hat always to do with respect?
I will start by commenting on a classroom practice where a teacher may be making students remove their hat so that they comply with school rules and also as a sign of respect. In a classroom, removing a hat is like saying, "Yes, sir." In fact, in a Western society, it is considered rude for men to wear a hat indoors.
So does that mean that in a Western society, the concept of hat is the opposite to Islam?
For them, a hat is considered an outside apparel, and it should be removed when one enters a building, with the possible exception of a store. A Western gentleman takes off his hat and holds it in his hand when a lady enters the elevator, for instance. Then again, in a Western society, usually hats are removed for the national anthem, passing of the flag and funeral processions, outdoor weddings, dedications and photographs.
So it means that one removes the hat to show respect in the Western society, unlike Islam?
I should say not only in Islam, but in certain other religions, wearing a hat is regarded as a symbol of respect. Haven't you seen Judaism cap or the Sikh turban? And haven't you seen the colorful turbans of Rajasthan in India, which are a must during any religious function, since for them it is a symbol of humility and surrendering to God.
Now it makes more sense. So one who uses a hat as part of their religious practices are trying to please God.
Indeed, it is about pleasing the God. For us, when we enter namaz, it is like entering the kingdom of Allah Ta'ala, where a hat is a must to show respect to our Creator.
I will make sure that I always have my hat, especially during namaz, when I am presenting myself in front of Allah.
And that is why wearing a hat has been the tradition of our blessed Holy Prophet of Allah and his companions and the great scholars and pious people after them.
Is not wearing a hat unlawful?
Let me conclude that even though not wearing a hat cannot be classed as unlawful or haram, it is a tradition and has become one of the universal symbols of Islam. It is generally undesirable to keep the head exposed. One should try to keep the head covered whenever, wherever, reasonably possible.
I would like to thank Mr. Imzachary for answering my questions and the viewers for listening. We're always looking for exciting new questions. So please send your questions to the email address listed at the bottom of your screen now. Inshallah, we look forward to bringing you new episodes very soon. Assalamu alaikum.
Drawing, painting and sketching can be real fun. So let's watch Sketch.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome to Sketch, your own little art corner on MTA. My name is Mubashir Ahmad. Today, we're going to be working with basic lines. I'm going to show you how to draw different lines and how to use those lines to draw different objects. As you know, that all objects or art or cartoons are comprised of or are composed of lines. So, when you have your pencils ready and your sheets of paper, let us start. For our first line, I'm going to teach you how to draw a circle. Keep your pen or your pencil on the paper like this and draw half a circle like so. Now, put your hand a little farther from the half circle that you drew and draw the other half like that. It doesn't have to be a perfect circle, but a circle. Let's draw another one. Inside the first one, hand on the paper like this, half a circle, a little farther away, the other half of the circle. I will give you a tip to draw circles, or to make it more easier to draw circles. Always start your practice with smaller circles. We are drawing it so that I can show you how to make circles, but if you draw a smaller circle, it is very easy. And as you go on to a bigger circle, your hand becomes more steady. For our next line, I'm going to show you how to draw a straight line, and we'll start with a vertical line. Hands on the paper like this, and come from top to bottom, like so. Easy? Let's draw another one. Right beside it, hand on the paper, like that. The tip in drawing a straight line, and especially a vertical line, is you have to keep your hand on the paper, keep it steady, and move the whole hand down. You can try again. Steady hand, top to bottom. And keep making smaller lines for your practice. Make a pattern like this. Okay? For our next line, we'll make a horizontal line. Keep your hand on the paper like this and go from left to right. Easy? Let's draw another one. Close to it, hand on the paper, left to right, like so. And the tip to drawing a horizontal line, or to draw it more easily, is keep your hand fixed on the paper and move the whole hand steadily like this. It is very easy. once you get to put in some practice. And the reason why I showed you the circle and the vertical line and then the horizontal line is because if you practice in that order, it gives you a very steady hand and you find it easier to draw different lines with different angles. Let's do another type of line, a wavy line. So hand on the paper and draw a wavy line like this. Let's try it one more time. Okay, for the other half of the wave, continue from where you left, put your hand a little farther, come like that. One more time. Continue from there. That's our wave. It doesn't have to be a perfect wave. Eventually, you will learn to draw a wave like this. But you have to move your hand along on the paper. Keep it steady. Now, let's draw a triangle using these same lines, but they're at a different angle. So, hand on the paper like this, one line. You're not moving your wrist this time. One more time, the other line is going to come down on the right-hand side. Okay? And we close it off with a horizontal line like this. One more time. Hand on the paper. Do not move your wrist. Just your fingers. First line. Hand on the paper. Second line. Just your fingers. And the horizontal lines, of course, you move your hand like that. Now that we have drawn different lines, let us use these lines to draw any object. Let's say a house. A house on the hill with on a bright sunny day. Okay? So let us start with the hill first. And the hill can be a wavy line as we practiced. Hand on the paper. And you can do it in one go or draw half a wavy line and then just go like this. We have a hill. Let's start drawing the house now. We'll start with two vertical lines. First line. And follow me. A little farther away, second line right down there. Now give it a little room. And let us draw the third line of the house, or the back of the house, another vertical line coming down like this. Again, don't have to be perfect lines, but vertical lines. Now, let us give a roof on the house, and we're going to draw a horizontal line this time, just like we practiced. Hand on the paper, and move your hand that far, and continue, hand farther away, and move your hand right across, till here. Okay? So far, so good. Now, if you remember, we did a triangle shape. The triangle goes on the roof of the house right in the front here. So we already have the bottom line. Let us draw that line first, and then close it off. Another horizontal line goes on top, right there. And then another line just as in the triangle to complete the roof of the house. So very basic lines, and we have our house on the hill. And you can use straight lines to vertical, horizontal lines to draw the windows and the doors as you like. Give it some paints, a chimney here, and two wavy lines for the smoke. But we said that it is a bright sunny day. So let us make a sun. Hand on the paper, we're going to draw a circle, of course. Half a circle like that. Hand a little farther away. Close it off. We have our sun. And let's make him smile. It's a nice bright day. Just add two eyes here, two eyebrows, and maybe some small lines like this right around to make some sun rays. You could even add some hills at the back with more wavy lines, or somewhere here. And we have our bright, sunny day with our house, and our drawing is complete. So we learn to use different lines to draw different objects. I would like you to practice with these lines. Draw some pictures and send them to us on the email address you see on the screens right now. We would love to have a look at them. Thank you for joining us today. Till next time, keep smiling, keep sketching. Jazakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
That's it for today. Join us next week, same day and same time. Assalamu alaikum.
Zulmat mita denge, nooron se basa denge. Hum Ahmadi bacche hain, kuch karke dikha denge. Shaitan ki hukumat ko duniya se mita denge.